Gimmicks have been an oddly integral part of the games industry. Early on, players would have to slap overlays on their television sets to simulate different styles of gameplay with the Magnavox Odyssey. Rob the Robot was packaged with the NES to market it as more of a toy rather than a video game console, which, ironically, worked well enough to practically save the games industry. The list of gimmicky accessories the NES sported is almost too long to recount. Sega, trying to keep up with Nintendo, had their own version of Nintendo's gimmicks, eventually leading to the Dreamcast Video Memory Unit, or VMU. Sony dabbled in the gimmick game with the PS2's iToy, the PlayStation Move for the PS3, culminating in the PS4's PlayStation VR headset. Finally, Microsoft dipped their toes in the waters of the gimmick sea with a Kinect and Kinect 2.0, utilizing your body instead of a traditional controller. I could make an entire video on the numerous new and weird ways we could all play games, from the Power Glove to the Toys to Life craze a few years back to nearly the entire existence of the Wii, but I wanted to focus on one of the best uses of a peripheral I've seen in my gears of gaming, and that was Guitar Hero. Recent news of Activision loading all of their developer eggs into one Warzone-shaped basket seemed eerily similar to when Activision milked the Guitar Hero franchise dry, so it inspired me to talk about it. A small aside on the Guitar Hero games before diving into the meat of this video. I pretty much consistently enjoyed the series from Guitar Hero 2 all the way up to 5. I vividly remember getting Guitar Hero 3 for Christmas and playing it non-stop. Guitar Hero World Tour's drum set currently collects dust in my basement. Its gameplay is pretty ingenious and can be played in all sorts of ways. Rocking out to your favorite tunes and actually feeling like you're on stage is a huge draw for the series. I even know people who played Guitar Hero in Rock Band, and they were stepping stones from them actually playing instruments like guitar and drums. Playing against your friends or family at parties or trying to go for the high score on Expert, I think we all remember our first time playing Through the Fire and Flames on pretty much any difficulty. The Guitar Hero franchise has a special place in my heart because it showcased a really neat way to play video games that differed from the norm, while also fulfilling a lot of Rockstar fantasies most people have, myself included. And being a fan during its heyday, I got to witness firsthand what would eventually happen to the franchise with such promise and potential. While it might have seemed revolutionary to those who first played it, Guitar Hero was not the first of its kind to use a guitar-like controller for a rhythm game. In 1999, Konami released an arcade title known as Guitar Freaks in Japan, which exploded in popularity. Players would use a guitar peripheral to simulate playing popular songs at the time by timing button presses and generally rocking out. There were many a failed attempt to bring Guitar Freaks to the West by publisher Working Designs, leaving a plastic guitar-shaped hole in the North American market. Inspired by Guitar Freaks' innovations in Japan, controller manufacturer Red Octane wanted to bring its fun arcade action to the home consoles of the West. Red Octane would reach out to Boston-based music developer Harmonix, who had cut their teeth in the genre with releases like Frequency and Amplitude for the PS2. Red Octane and Harmonix partnered up, and together they released the original Guitar Hero on PS2 in November of 2005. Using the guitar controller designed by Red Octane, players simulated rocking out to classic songs from the 70s, 80s, 90s, and early 2000s. This proved to be insanely popular, as the game would rake in $45 million for the publisher and developer duo. The surprise success saw Harmonix diving right into pre-production for its sequel, Guitar Hero 2. With a solid base to start with, Harmonix was able to pump out Guitar Hero 2 in little less than a year, releasing in November of 2006. The success of the original carried over to its sequel, only being outsold by the original Gears of War in 2006, and more than doubling the sales numbers of the original, making nearly $200 million. The rapid success would be a curse in disguise, as it attracted the attention of that which would be its eventual downfall. Prior to Guitar Hero 2's release, Harmonix would be bought out by MTV Games of all companies, while Activision would acquire Red Octane that same year. This would mean that Harmonix would no longer be able to work on the series it had created, and instead would seek other ventures with EA to create the lucrative Rock Band series, as well as Dance Central. Rock Band would fall victim to EA just as Guitar Hero would to Activision, but we only have time for one train wreck this time around. Maybe next time. Almost immediately, Activision wanted to take the Guitar Hero franchise to nearly every conceivable platform. As soon as the acquisition was finalized, Activision pushed for a port of Guitar Hero 2 to the then-new Xbox 360. At the same time, Harmonix was finishing up a contractual obligation on the expansion pack to Guitar Hero 2 in the form of Guitar Hero Encore Rock the 80s. The former would launch in June of 2007, with the latter hitting 360 in April. At this time, with Harmonix gone, Activision tapped Tony Hawk's Pro Skater veterans Neversoft to take the reins of the main series of the Guitar Hero franchise. With Neversoft hard at work at Guitar Hero 3 Legends of Rock, one of the best entries in the franchise, I might add, Activision wanted to keep the pedal to the metal regardless of how fast the cliff was approaching. Legends of Rock released in 2007, just a year after Guitar Hero 2 and 5 measly months after Rock the 80s. Guitar Hero 3 was the most versatile of the entries so far. Beforehand, the series was mostly relegated to the PS2, but Guitar Hero 3 released on the PS2, PS3, Xbox 360, Wii, and PC. Despite 4 games in 3 years, Legends of Rock was the best-selling entry in the franchise thus far. far, recouping Activision's initial investment in the series in its first few weeks, leading to over $830 million in total lifetime sales. In my opinion, Guitar Hero 3 was where the series peaked in more ways than one. It felt like the most refined and feature-complete entry in the whole franchise. It would also be where the series peaked financially as well. While Rock the 80s and Guitar Hero 3 were being released, Activision slipped in Guitar Hero 3 Mobile, developed by Machine Works Northwest LLC in 2007. There would be three releases on mobile devices from 2007 to 2009, including Guitar Hero 3 Mobile, as well as Guitar Hero Backstage Pass and Guitar Hero World Tour Mobile. By now, you might be noticing a very glaring issue, and while these were just small mobile titles and ports, I bring them up only to showcase the clear direction Activision was going. I don't fault any company or developer for striking while the iron is hot, so to speak. Capitalizing on the popularity of your product is good business, but there's a difference between giving the people what they want and drowning them in it. To recap up to this point, we had Guitar Hero 1 in 2005, Guitar Hero 2 in 2006, which was ported to the 360 in 2007, the same year Rock the 80s, Guitar Hero Mobile, and Guitar Hero 3 were all released. That's six games in a matter of 3 years, and it only got worse. 2008 rolls around, and the Guitar Hero train is full steam ahead. Neversoft pumped out Guitar Hero Aerosmith, which was released in June of 2008, just months before the next major installment in the series, but before then, Activision would release two DS games in the form of Guitar Hero On Tour in June of 2008, and On Tour Decades, releasing in November of that year, both developed by Vicarious Visions. Meanwhile, Harmonix had released Rock Band the year prior, implementing an entire ensemble of instruments, including drums and vocals. Well, Activision wasn't above taking a peek at EA's homework a bit, so Guitar Hero World Tour would implement similar mechanics, including a drum kit and a microphone. Releasing in October of 2008, World Tour would also launch on the Xbox 360, PS3, PS2, Wii, and PC. Even so, it sold half as many units as Guitar Hero 3 did just 1 year prior. Four games in 1 year had clearly taken a toll on the series' popularity as fatigue was setting in, but that didn't stop Activision. 2009 is the year the series nearly died. Five titles, including two spin-off games, were released between March and December. Guitar Hero Metallica was released in March, developed by Neversoft. Guitar Hero Smash Hits was curated by Beenox and released in June. Guitar Hero On Tour Modern Hits was released for the DS also in June, and again developed by Vicarious Visions. Guitar Hero 5 released in September. Band Hero released in November, both of which were Neversoft projects. DJ Hero came out in October, developed by Freestyle Games. And finally, Guitar Hero Van Halen released in December in North America and February 2010 everywhere else, produced by Underground Entertainment. Sweet Jesus. Granted, one could make the argument that the Guitar Hero entries on the DS and mobile titles were to serve a separate audience, and that Aerosmith, Metallica, and Van Halen games were more expansion packs, and that Band and DJ Hero were spin-offs to capture different markets, and I'd respond with asking how much Activision paid you to defend this nonsense. Oversaturation doesn't even begin to cover it, as a total of 18, let me repeat that, 18 games were released in one manner or another from 2005 to 2009. That's insane. That's not even mentioning what ungodly things EA was doing to the Rock Band series in an even shorter time span, and the various other developers and publishers who wanted to hop on the Guitar Hero bandwagon, like Rock the Dead, Rock Revolution, Power Gig, and Popstar Guitar. Even if you were in love with plastic instruments that allowed you to simulate playing a real guitar in a video game, this is overkill, and the public agreed. Guitar Hero Warriors of Rock, which I completely forgot existed to be honest, would release in September of 2010 and was estimated in selling a measly 86,000 units in its launch month, with DJ Hero 2 not faring much better. In total, North American sales of both Warriors of Rock and DJ Hero were well below 1 million copies sold in 2010, a drastic 63% decrease in the combined sales of Guitar Hero 5, DJ Hero, and Band Hero the year before. The magic was officially gone, and due to weak sales numbers, Activision closed its Guitar Hero business unit down in 2011. While Guitar Hero would be rebooted with 2015's Guitar Hero Live, a very Activision-focused Guitar Hero title, if I might add, the series would never return to the same heights it experienced with Legends of Rock. Guitar Hero's meteoric rise and catastrophic fall should be taught in universities around the globe on how to not run your business. Activision not only oversaturated the market with these titles, effectively killing this subgenre, but it also took a toll on the games themselves. In game development, iteration is usually the norm when it comes to sequels or new entries in a franchise. Take what works and improve on it and add new twists to make each title unique. The volume of titles coming out of the Guitar Hero franchise didn't have time to mix up the formula or add new mechanics, and when it did, it was just a shallow attempt at copying the competition. Activision was only focused on short-term success instead of longevity. Laugh if you want, but DJ Hero is pretty cool. It's unique and offers a different experience with wildly different music, and as a spin-off game, it succeeds in that department. But because it released in a literal sea of competition brought on by its own publisher, it failed due to apathy, if anything else. If Activision played their cards right, Guitar Hero could have been an empire, with spin-off games spanning multiple different instruments or music genres, but instead, they turned their developers into an assembly line of sorts. Like a leech, they squeezed every last drop out of the name and moved on to something. something else. Guitar Hero is a cautionary tale of what greed can do in a market as volatile as the games industry. Now, I'm not saying that recent events would put into motion Activision milking Call of Duty and Warzone until each year is dry as the Sahara. Call of Duty has an install base the size of a small country that shows up year in and year out, but with the recent effort to remaster games like Call of Duty 4 and Modern Warfare 2, Warzone spanning multiple titles and nearly 10 developers working on the series, it's not out of the realm of possibility. Hell, Activision did nearly the same thing with Skylanders just a few years back, seizing the opportunity to take advantage of something genuinely unique and leaving the husk of what's left after becoming less lucrative. Let's just hope Bobby Kotick learned his lesson, but I think we all know he hasn't.